Hello, everybody. Welcome to this webinar. I can see there are lots of people that we've got live on this webinar today. Wow, we've got a ton of you. I think this has probably been the most attended session that we've had so far. So the reason I asked Cathy to come and do this webinar with this particular topic is because I think Cathy's someone who's got a really great story. She came across what I use and what a number of you guys use, which is the three principles. And she heard about it at a Joe Bailey seminar that she was at, and she told this story to me about 4 years ago now. And what was really incredible about Cathy is that she went and started teaching this in Santa Clara County and took it into the prison system there. But she did it, you know, it wasn't kind of 5 years down the road when she'd got lots of practice and she'd done all these things. She went and applied for a grant, got the funding, and got someone else who was more experienced to kind of help deliver it and really take the lead on that. In fact, she put the other person's name on the paperwork. And she's a great example of someone who's worked in so many different areas. You know, a lot of people know her for the work in the prison system that she's done, but she's also worked in business. She did work at BA Systems. You know, she's worked in lots of different areas. And she was telling me the other day that people often associate her with the work she's done in the prisons, which she's most well known for, but she's worked across the board in many different areas. So the thing I really like about Cathy is she just shows up, and she's not one of those people that, you know, is all about, let's just wait for the feeling. We'll get into a nice feeling and then I'll take action. She's really someone who, message, but I'm really curious as to what people want to know on this webinar. You know, this webinar was really about how do you get started in coaching? How do you get started in your coaching practice? I know there are a bunch of new coaches in this group. I'm happy to edit this out or edit this together, and I'm going to put this together as a replay for people to be able to watch and listen. But really, I wanted to interview Cathy originally and get her thoughts and share her story. But then really, with a lot of the webinars, really wanted to answer your questions. So if there are people in the group that are wanting me to answer these any questions around how do you get started as a coach, then please let me know. I'm happy to answer the questions that you have, and the more detail the better, because I think sometimes with generic questions, when you said just where do I get started, it's so generic that I find that, you know, getting into details better. And one thing that I'll say just as we start off is that there are so many different ways to coach. There are so many different ways that you can be successful in this profession. And I think the mistake is that people try and find the way, you know, the one way that you can be successful, the one way to get started. And there really isn't one way. And I've come across so many different coaches over the last few years who are successful. And when I look at it, they're all doing different things. So someone may be using Facebook, someone else might be using like meetup groups, someone else might be giving talks, someone else may be writing letters to ex-colleagues and doing business coaching, you know, someone may be working in the public sector and putting together proposals, but it's a variety of different things. So there isn't one way to get started, and in fact, one thing that I would like to say is that the best thing that we can do as coaches, and this is if you're absolutely brand new, or if you know, or even if you've been coaching for a while, is to focus on things that you enjoy, because we bring ourselves to our coaching practices, and even in terms of sharing the principles in our coaching, there's so many different ways that we can do that. You know, some people write books, you know, and that's been really helpful. But if you don't enjoy writing books, why put that on yourself? Because you don't need to do that. If you needed to write a book in order to be a successful coach, fine, that might be something you need to just get over, but it's not necessary. So I can see Adam, you've sent a question through. As a beginner, what did you find the best way of getting clients and Ankush conversations, social media? Well, I can tell you, Adam, that at the beginning, I really struggled. I really, really struggled to get clients. And it seemed like a bit of a dark art for me to do that. And I am going back when I was a beginner about 4.5 years ago. And, you know, what I'd heard is you just need to take action. Just take action, just show up, and you'll learn along the way and you'll be successful. And that worked to the extent that it worked. But what happened was that it wasn't as consistent as I would have liked it. I was meeting people who I knew I could help and they weren't interested in working with me. In fact, they'd often go off and hire someone else who was an outside-in coach, and I could see it would be less beneficial for them, in my opinion at least. And I really struggled, and you know, I couldn't figure it out, and I was in that space for a good eight or nine months. And in that 8 or 9 month period, I got really only one proper paid coaching client. I mean, I had a friend who was a client who paid me. I did some work with Jamie where we both coached someone, but really a client that I created on my own that didn't know me before, that I worked with who paid me, I only created one. And it wasn't a lot of money. And at that rate, I was thinking, this is going to take me forever. Is this really feasible for me to coach from this, you know, forget from this understanding, just coach in any way? You know, it was really, really difficult. And I didn't expect that. And then I read The Prosperous Coach, which isn't a three principles book, but it gave me some kind of guidance. And I don't do everything that's in the book, but what that pointed me to was really serving people. And what I found was, and what I realized, I wasn't serving people. I was having sales conversations up until that point. This is just me. And instead, I set up conversations with people where I could help them, and I tried to help them. And at the end of the conversation, I would, you know, then ask them if they wanted to continue. I made a proposal, and I was just starting out. I didn't really know what I was doing, but I started to sign up clients. And what happened is, with each client, I got better and better. And with each client, it became easier, should I say? And that was just my way. And my way of getting into conversations was through Facebook. So I could see people on Facebook who were struggling with whatever struggles they had. I was in a lot of men's self-development communities online, but I was applying things from The Prosperous Coach, and it would just happen that I was spending time on Facebook. Now, if you're not on Facebook, you don't need to do this, but it was really with people who knew a little bit about me already. And so when I was reaching out to them, I could get into a dialogue quite easily. They weren't completely cold to me. They either knew me or knew of me, or had seen me post online. And then from there, we got into a conversation, and it was all about service up front, trying to help them, sharing things with them. I used to share a lot of Jamie Smart audios that I had access to that weren't publicly available, and I'd share them with people because I thought they could help people that were struggling with various different things. And from there, it just unfolded into some of them wanting to sign up with me. So that was really when I was a beginner. But I've coached other coaches now who are starting out, and I never tell people to, well, that's not true, not never, but I'm not really trying to make people clones of me or telling them what to do most of the time. I might give suggestions, but I know that everyone can do this in their own way. So if you're, if you've got a great network of business contacts, then it makes sense to go and talk to those business contacts. If you've got different networks or places where you're already known, it makes sense to go to those places. And I know I've got a client of mine who wasn't really active on Facebook. He was well known more so in his local community. So I got him and pointed him to just sharing in that community and start serving people in that community, and his practice grew. So it's just horses for courses. But Yes, we can hear you. Hi,
Yay.
Cathy.
Yay. We did it. Sorry about that.
It's okay. It's okay. This, I was just telling everyone, this proves to everyone that we're live. And
I'm willing to go longer. If people want to hang in there longer, I'm happy to stay on longer. So
yeah. And I want to just say thank you to Eva who sent me your cell phone so we could talk this out.
Yes. Yes.
So just to bring you up to date, Cathy, what I was saying is that I wanted to bring you on and talk about this particular subject in particular about how do I get started coaching, because you were someone who went to a Joe Bailey seminar, heard something, and then very quickly went and took the three principles into the jail system in Santa Clara County. And so you're someone that I see that doesn't wait around for a nice feeling before you do something. And we've got a lot of coaches in our group who may be familiar with the three principles to whatever mm-hmm. level they are. So some are more trained, some are not. But a lot of them are struggling to where do we get started?
Yes.
Now Adam Ash, who's online, who I know is a rugby player, asked me a question whilst I was waiting to try and get you on board around where did I start. And I said I struggled when I started off, and what one thing that worked really for me was just to go where I was already at. So for me, I was on Facebook and I was in a lot of personal development forums on Facebook, and I just went away from trying to sell anything to anyone and went more to service and thought, how can I help people, what can I share with them? And then eventually that would lead to conversations, and I started to create clients. But that's kind of my experience. So I'd love to also hear from you. And I know you also work with coaches too. So interested in what you might have to say.
Sure. And yeah, believe it or not, my practice right now are a lot of people who've gone through many trainings who are now, well, now what? You know, how do I get started? Or I'm starting and nothing's happening. You know, that seems to be the next phase for a lot of people. For me, and I don't know if I've kind of had this knowing even before I knew the principles, but sometimes something hits me. Like when I heard the principles from Joe Bailey, my first thought is, wow, I'm going to do something with this. I don't know yet what it's going to be. So that was my first big thought. And I even went up to somebody who, another presenter, Miss Beverly, even knows who that is. And I went up to her and I said, I don't know what it's going to be, but you and I are going to do something together. So, and I had not a clue at that time of what it was going to be, but I just had this desire. So basically it's kind of like, it's something hits you in a way that you don't know how it's going to play out, but it's something you have a vision for, a dream to do, a passion for. So I think that's really necessary. You know, something that really hits you where you live, something that, wow, that would be cool if I could do that. So, and it's interesting, I was in Oslo doing a training with Eric, and his group was in the same situation. They didn't know how to go about things. They didn't know what to do next. And so I've sat there kind of like pondering, now what's the deal? Because I could ask them, well, what's holding you up? And, you know, why is that? And get people to see it's just their thinking holding them up. And I thought, well, no, that we kind of all know that. Obviously, our thinking holds us up for everything. And finally, I thought, well, forget all that. And then I just asked them if they could wave a magic wand and they could fantasize the ultimate thing they would like to do, whether it's, you know, teaching the principles in a place they really want to or anything, what would that be like? You know, just go into your imagination. No holds barred, no issues around time, no issues about money. No, just consider something that you would love to do, or a fantasy that you have. And wow, after we did that exercise, and we had everybody share, well, what is it that they fantasized of what they love to do? What we noticed was it was different than what they thought they should do. You know what I mean? It's kind of like, well, this would be a good idea to teach, you know, or coach or do this kind of thing. their fantasy was totally different than what they thought they wanted to do. So I think what happened to me at the beginning, and this has kind of been me all my life, is something occurs to me like, wow, I would really like to do that. Or, I wonder what that's like. Now, guess what the theme is? Total curiosity. Total like, oh, wow, what's that all about? You know, it's like being a kid. You know how kids, they go around, they have no thinking about, you know, wanting to be a fireman. Well, I'm going to be a fireman when I grow up. Now, they don't sit and consider, oh, it's dangerous, or, you know, are they physically equipped to do it? Or kids just, they just have these ideas about, wow, I want to be a fireman, or I want to be an astronaut, or I want to be. So do you get this, the theme I'm pointing to? It's just allowing yourself to dream. And to me, the dream is in you already. See, it's almost like as soon as I realized, I don't know what it's going to be, but it's going to be something, it was a done deal. And my job is to just kind of follow it, you know, just kind of let it unfold. So now it took me, it was funny. So once I had that big, you know, hit, I was sitting in the jail doing another project. So I hadn't even thought about teaching the principals in the jail. So I'm in doing this other job. It was a research data collection where we're literally asking newly arrested inmates what kinds of drugs they were using out on the street, because they wanted to keep tabs throughout the country of what the drug trends were. So it was called the Drug Use Forecasting Project. So I'm in there doing that data collection, right? Running a team, doing interviews. And so I'm sitting there on the women's side in the women's facility, and I'm waiting for my team to finish doing their interviews. And meanwhile, I'm overhearing women just stressing out on the phone. They're calling home and they're crying, they're upset. It's almost like as soon as they get off the phone call, they fall apart. And that's when it hit me, oh, wait a minute, maybe they would benefit from learning the principles. See, it hit me right there. Now, up until that point, nothing had occurred to me. And it was all in that moment, seeing how stressed they were. So it's, I love what you said, Ankush, when you said you started where your life was. See, my life was, I was actually sitting in the jail doing another job. So that was my life. And then I sort of looked over and thought, well, wow, that might be a possibility. Called a friend and calling. I said, told her the idea. She said, well, let's go for it. And so we then proceeded to find out where funding sources were. We then proceeded to write a proposal. So then we did the footwork. You know, then we did what was necessary. And lo and behold, and we did this in a coffee shop. I mean, we literally went to a coffee shop. And we had never taught the principles. We read everything we could, and we wrote stuff up, and we cut and paste things, you know, literally cut things out, paste them on a piece of paper. Then they wanted a curriculum, so we sat there and we literally made up a curriculum. We made it up in thin air. Well, how many weeks? Well, you know, 16, 20 weeks, no, maybe 6 weeks. Oh, we'll do 8 weeks. Okay, now for 8 weeks, what are we gonna do? So then we took each week, each class, and we just brainstormed. Well, we'll talk about mind. And then we did a little curriculum. Then we'll talk about consciousness. And then we did a little curriculum. Anyway, we submitted the proposal. And blow me up, we got funded. We got funded. And then she and I looked at each other and we said, now what do we do? Because we've never taught before. We don't know how to teach. So are you hearing? We literally were out there. And so we did write in somebody who we knew would be helpful, but we hadn't even asked her to be a part of our program. So we had to call this person and say, listen, we wrote you into this program and we got funded. Are you available? So again, it was a constant, you know, in the unknown. But it was the certainty. I don't know what it was. It was just kind of like that, like, this is something I really want to do.
You know, that's where you hit the nail on the head, Cathy, and that's what I really want to pull out from that piece. Because when I started coaching, I trained with someone, you know, Jamie Smart, and Jamie said to me, well, you know, some people come onto my program and they think they want to be coaches, and they get to the end of it and then they don't want to coach. They realize they want to do it. And he was kind of like, you know, giving me both sides, and because I'd known him and we got a lot of mutual friends. He goes, look, I want to be really open with you. And I said, that's great, Jamie. I don't care about anyone else. I'm going to be a coach. And the funny thing is, for me, I wanted to be a coach before I knew anything about the three principles.
Yes.
I had been around the personal development world for about 11 years. I'd done loads of stuff. And, this might be blasphemous because it's outside in stuff, but I'd got value out of it. I'd changed. I'd grown as a person.
Absolutely.
I'd learned a lot of things. And I really wanted to help people. But what I really wanted to do was coach. And so I found a way. I didn't know exactly how I was going to do it. Yes, I signed up to a program, but there was so much other stuff to learn and go and explore and get curious about and make mistakes. But it's what I wanted to do. And what I hear and what you just said, Cathy, and I love that we're starting with this piece, is that you started from a place of, this is what I really want to do. And I was talking to Dickon about this a few weeks ago, actually a few months ago. And I was delivering a training in London for coaches with Steve Chandler. And Dickon said, one of the issues he sees, and I think we're both pointing to this, one of the issues he sees is some people think they ought to be coaching, they should be coaching,
yes,
like this is what they yes need to do, or yes a version of that, and they don't really want to coach.
Yes.
And
yes
he told me a story of his own daughter who, you know, she'd been brought up and around this, and then one day she kind of went up to him and, Dad, I don't want to do this, I want to do something else. And he went, that's beautiful. You don't need to be a coach or a teacher or a psychologist. You just do what you love to do.
This is amazing because I'm mentoring a lot of people, and I would say half the people I've mentored, they were able to come to that realization. And it's funny because I almost want to say, if you have your heart set on something and you're going to get mentored by me, you better look out because it may not end up turning out that way. That's kind of a joke, but no, it's interesting. And that's what we found in Oslo. We have this idea of what we should do or what we think we want to do, when actually that's coming from our head versus something like what you said. That came from your heart. I really want to do this. See, that comes from your heart. And if something doesn't come from that place, then yeah, you may get there, but you won't, it'll be work. It will be work. If you talk to every successful person, you will find that they'll say things like, well, there's no way I couldn't do this. It's like, I have to do this. You hear people, well, there's no other way. Now, when I hear people say, well, I'm doing this so that I can do something else. See, that's where the disconnect is. So it's like, well, if you're kind of not connected to where you are now and you're waiting to get connected later, see, that's where we get into trouble. That's when it gets, and again, so, and nobody pointed that out to me. It was just intuitively, I knew that. So everything I've been gotten, and even before the principles, I've been in civil rights. I've been in the women's movement, civil rights movement. Everything I've done since the time I was 12 years old, believe it or not, it hit me like, wow, I would love to be a recreational leader and help kids who don't get anything. You know, I love to do, and so there I am. There I am doing it. There I am doing it. So it's really that place, that knowing, like what you said, I really want to be a coach.
Yeah.
This is something I really see for myself. So I think mostly just, you know, whenever you can, and this is literally telling people, giving advice right now, but sit back and dream. You know, start dreaming. Visualize. What is it that if you could have people know you in, you know, at some point, what would you have them know about you? What is it that you would fantasize that they would know or say about you? You know, what is that? And it's amazing. So when we did that exercise in Oslo, Eric and I went, whoa, because I was you know, I'd been across many groups where people are kind of stuck and they're not moving. And I had to get creative. I had to get into me and say, well, you know, let's forget everything else we've done around this. Forget that. And then it hit me.
I want to get to people's questions.
Yeah. Love to answer questions.
I don't know how much longer I can go over 7 p.m., but so I want to get as much as we can.
So
Grayson's asked a question. You talked about you mentoring people. I've got coaches that I work with too, and I kind of coach and mentor them. And Grayson's asking, when starting out, what do you think is the value of getting coached by an established coach or doing a course? And I think it's a great question because we had a conversation about that. Last week.
I'll
pass that over to you first.
Now, an established coach in what? Just being a coach, going to coach school, or I'm not sure about the question. Being mentored by somebody who's been doing it for a long time, or an experienced person.
Grayson, if you want to just type and give us some more information around that. I think generically, though, I think there are a lot of people, and this is kind of from the more generic coaching world as well. So maybe let's talk to that first while we're waiting for Grayson to write. You know, there seems to be this a lot of people saying, you know, if you want to be a coach, you need to have a coach. You know, or in order to share the principles, you need to do one of these training courses, and there are loads of them out there. By very well-known three principles coaches themselves, and there does seem to be discussions online. So Grayson's saying 3P coach specifically.
Okay,
so,
great. Okay, yeah, got it.
You know, is that needed? Because I know you didn't do that, but I did.
I didn't do that. Okay, well here's what I would recommend. Actually, I didn't formally, you know, sign up to have somebody mentor me, but I certainly look to people who were around this longer than me. So while I was out doing what I was doing, believe me, there were times when I would go sit with Roger Mills, who he was an expert at taking this into community. There were times when I sat with Mark Howard and learned how to use this as a therapy, you know, one-on-one with people. And there were times when I would listen to George Pransky, or ultimately, you know, of course, listen to Sydney Banks any chance I got. So I didn't have them mentor me formally, but anytime they gave talks or they had events or they had their own training programs, yes, I did do a year-long training with Roger. So that was the only formal training that I did. And it was probably four weekend sessions. But I think what made a difference was it had nothing to do with what I was doing. It was more me coming in and just seeing the principles deeper, you know, seeing it deeper. Because as I saw the principles deeper, then my work changed as a result. So over time, how I worked with people changed as I sat with people or listened to people. Now, to be honest with you, Roger did do kind of a more structured how-to, like, you know, when you're working with a group of people. And to this day, I would say a lot of how I work with people came from that experience. It came from that experience as well as working with Beverly when we did it together in the jail system. And then, of course, as I started training in other systems like the business world and doing it a different way in the business world, I've incorporated that into how I work with people. So over time, I did look outside of myself to see, well, how are they doing this in business? And then going to observe and see, well, how does it play out there? So yes, I was a student as much as I could be, along with doing it. So what you need to do is, who is it that you resonate with? You know, who is it that you feel connected to? You know, so yeah. Find somebody that you trust and sign up with them. Or if somebody's doing a training of trainer program, sign up with them. But do it from your heart. Don't do it from, well, I should do this to be a trainer or a coach, as opposed to, wow, I really want to hear what he has to say. And that's how I ended up in business. I literally ran up to the guy from the business world that George was working with. And I said, I would love to come and watch how you guys do this. You know, just be an observer. And he said, no problem, come on out. So I literally just showed up to watch, you know, George and his team. Well, guess what? During that time, they ended up hiring me because George made me participate. He said, no observers, you have to participate. So he made me do some small groups and he made me do things. Even though I told him I wasn't qualified, I had never done it before, they threw me in and I ended up getting hired. So again, I was willing just to be a student. So it occurred, I would love to, how does this play out in business? Again, that curiosity, seizing the opportunity, you know, asking to, can I just hang out and observe you or whatever? But it's just my willingness to do that.
So Grayson's commented, and what he's commented on, I would love to talk to.
Yeah.
And because I love what you said. And Grayson said, I feel some people get caught up in courses, etc., and try to emulate others rather than just coach from their wisdom.
Absolutely.
I'm enjoying what is unfolding. So at this stage, want to not get involved with a particular training. I enjoy observing and learning as I go, as you've said, Cathy.
Yeah.
So I think that's a really important point because I did training. And I still do training. I've invested tens of thousands of pounds in my training, as well as a lot of time and energy. And what I've also found is any training I've done, this is before I came across the three principles, you know, any training I've ever done in my life, whether it was through work or I paid for it myself, or it was a 3P course or a non-3P course, I've never come across a training where 100% of the people that were on the course had like all amazing results out of it. You know, there seems to be like this distribution where some people come on a course and they get absolutely nothing. Mm-hmm. You get a bunch of people who get some transformation and you get, you know, one or two people who, you know, it's life changing. I'm kind of generalizing, but this is roughly what I've seen.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so what I think, one of the issues I see in you know, because people are going, should I do a course? Should I not do a course? There's no right answer to that. But what I see is that if you think, a course, you know, you are, you know, going to go on the course and you will be anointed, right? And you'll get a nice little certificate at the end of it, which proves that you are now trained to share the three principles.
And therefore,
that's not simply how it works.
And I love
what you said, Cathy, about how you learned from Roger and Mark and other people, but you also learned from your experience. That's exactly what I've seen.
So I've learned from
Jamie. I know you were I think you were the first 3P person, second 3P person I met.
Yeah.
I met Garrett first on Jamie's course, and then I met you. And I learned loads from you guys, and I met Keith Blevins through that course. But I learned so much when I went up to, I remember this, 2 months in, I went up and I somehow convinced my leadership team to allow me to talk for an hour in their meeting.
I remember that.
And this is like my boss and his boss and all his direct reports. And I'm standing there and I'm like flailing and I'm like blah, 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 blah. Right. And it was like a train wreck. And I came out of it. Funnily enough, though, people did come up to me and said, we don't know what the hell you were talking about. One guy goes, I don't know what you're talking about, but I've seen a different side to you. I learned from that. And through all of these things that when I show up and do experience and had experience and tried things out, I could come back to the courses, ask people like you questions and get the most of it. So I don't think it's either or.
I don't
think there's nothing that you have to do. I think if you do a course, it can be really helpful.
Go
and get experience. That can be really helpful. And you don't need to do anything. You don't need a coach. We both make some of our income from coaching others, but I think we'd both say, I'm speaking for you, that no one needs to hire us.
No. In fact, my goal is to, you know, if somebody wants to work with me, my goal is to get them up and running as soon as possible. But see, what I saw with you when you told me you're going to do that, I remember you were going to go speak at this meeting. As soon as I see that, I thought, oh, he's going to be successful. He's going for it. See, I would rather somebody be out there falling flat on their face or not know what the hell they're doing or whatever you want to call that to me and then come back to me and say, Cathy, this is what I did. This is what I have. I said, wow, fabulous. Okay, what happened? What happened? So that you do it again. Okay, what happened? What happened? You do it again. See, when people call me, I say, are you doing, first of all, do you want to do the work? Is this what you want to do? And are you doing it yet? Now, if they're not doing it yet, I said, well, you're wasting your money because you're going to learn. I want you to bring in your work and let's talk about it. That to me is where the learning happens, as opposed to being in a course and not doing it yet. So I tell people, go down to Starbucks and grab three people and say, listen, could I share something I know? And do you have time? And, you know, I'm practicing or however you want to do it. Just do something if that's what you want to do. So I think you're right. I think people who go out and do it, and people have come up to me and they say, you know, I've been doing this for 3 years and I haven't been able to talk to anybody about this because they're kind of out in the middle of nowhere. And this is before YouTube and live streaming and all that was happening. They're just out there in the boondocks doing the work. And they were so grateful to go to conferences or to maybe call me on the phone because they had nothing to bounce it off of. Well, listening to these folks, because they had to rely on their own wisdom and rely on maybe reading more or what, but they were kind of just on their own. I was totally blown away with the work they were doing. So I think you're absolutely right. There's no one formula to this. There's no one way. And it didn't even occur to me. The only reason why I hung out with Roger is because he had invited us in to work with him as he did the trainings here locally. He asked us to participate, to be his facilitators. And I'm like, well, I don't know how to facilitate a group. And he said, doesn't matter. You're just going to be my eyes and ears. And so he just included us as being part of the process. So it was very organic. You know, it's like, I wasn't even realizing I was learning. So yes, if you've gone through, like one woman I'm working with, I think she's gone through like 8 trainings. And I looked at her, I said, you've got to stop, stop. She was talking about going to, I said, stop. Even if you're not going to train, stop this, because what's happening is you're looking outside of yourself to something that you've known since day one. So I've seen it many different ways.
Yeah. You reminded me of a client that I had, who kept bombarding, we started working together and he just kept bombarding me with questions. He's like, what do you do with this? And what do you do with that? And what about this? And what about that? And I just said, I said, I refuse to answer any more questions you have until you go out and do something.
That's it. That's right? It. That's it.
And then I will talk to you because you're right. It's wasting money. So, Grayson said, thanks so much for your answers, guys.
Oh,
really resonates with me.
My pleasure.
I'm definitely going to go on courses and link up with coaches because I really want to connect with others who share the principles. Cool.
Great.
So Clasia's got a great question.
Yes.
She said, I work for a banking corporation, recently become aware there's a £40,000 funding available for a project run by employees supporting the community. I'm thinking about creating a 3P related project, but don't know how to design a program or what to include in the proposal. Please, can you give me some pointers?
Well, here's the deal about writing proposals. You really want to find out what it is that you want to get a sense of their take on things. So I do this both when I work with individuals, groups, as well as writing up a proposal. And just to give you an example, I was called in by a nursing director of this huge public hospital. She had heard me speak somewhere, and one of her key managers, popular, well-loved nursing managers, committed suicide. So she was frantically looking to do something. And so my name came up. So she invited me in. And so immediately you would think, okay, we need to do something around the grieving process. You know, you would think that, right? Somebody, you know, died and it impacted the organization. But guess what? See, that's my assumption. So when I went to meet with her, I looked at her and I said, okay. And so it's like she unloaded on me. And she's a very high powered, intense, very narcissistic ego kind of person. But yet she just sort of, and told me she only had 20 minutes, but then an hour and a half later, she's just telling me about this and about that. And so as I'm listening, I'm thinking, oh, this is what they're, this is what she's wanting to happen. Oh, wait a minute. This is, so finally at the end, I looked at her, I said, now given everything that you've shared, what do you want for your nurse managers and your nurses? What would you want for them? And she looked at me, she goes, they have to know how to bounce back. And I said, so you're talking about resiliency here. She said, yes, I want my nurses to have more resilience. And I said, okay, well, we can do that. Now, you would assume it's grief, but after I spent time with her, it ended up being something totally different. So when you want to work with a group, you want to get their take. Well, what is it that they want to see happen? What do they think is holding, you know, things up for them? You want to look for the what is so important to them. But sometimes you have to kind of get in there with them because it could look like grief, but actually it's something else. So with your group, why do they want to do this? What is it that, you know, they're looking to do? What is their vision? What do they see as the, you know, gets in the way of maybe people doing more, whatever, but you want to get a sense of their world. And then you design the program. So I designed a resiliency program. So we started with resiliency. So that's what you want to do is kind of pull for that theme.
You know, I love what you're saying, Cathy, and I'd love to add to that. And I've not done kind of this kind of public sector work, but this it's all the same.
It could be business, it could be nonprofit, yeah.
There's so many similarities. You're reminding me, Steve and I did an event last year for coaches, and I sat down and I thought, Steve, you know, you're going to want to like really be structured and all of this sort of stuff. You know, how do you put together this program? And he said, well, no, he goes, my ideal program is just to sit and talk to people. And I said, you know what? Me too. Right. But we needed to come up with a structure for people. So we sat down and we said, well, what are the things that we would like to talk about? And we just came off the top of our head. And I have to admit, I had this like resistance to any kind of structure. Like, I don't want to do a sales page. I don't want to put together what we're going to cover because it's so in the moment. But it wasn't that bad. We just talked and we said, well, these are some of the things. Oh, yeah, that's a point. I'd like to make that point. Oh, yeah, that's it. We wrote that down. And then that was it. That was our program. And then what happened was when we actually delivered this 2-day program, this 2-day workshop, we kind of talked for half an hour and then we went, right, now what do you guys want to do? And I remember some of the people that are on the call tonight were at the event. And I remember guy from my point of view, it was people like, oh, you're involving us now, right? You know, it's not just coming one way.
Yes.
But it's so true because it's a moment to moment thing. And just because you put something in a program, it doesn't mean like it needs to look exactly like that when it's delivered. That's just going through the hoop. And ultimately, I think whether they're 3 principals, coaches or trainers or non-3P coaches and trainers, the best coaches and trainers in the world respond to what the group wants in the moment.
That's it. So
don't get too hung up on, I would say too hung up on what the program looks like. It's great. I love what you said about asking them why do they put this project together? What do they want? And then kind of match it. The other thing I want to say as well, Cathy, which came to me as well about doing group work and doing programs like this for people is similar to what we were saying about coaching earlier on, is focus on what you're good at. So some advice that I got earlier on from my coach was, look, if you want to go into and he was talking to me about business, and he goes, look, if you want to go into a business, because I was thinking, oh, I'm going to have to do this training, I'm going to have to do this and this. And he said, look, what are you good at? What do you know you're good at? What's your strong point? And I said, well, I love coaching. One-on-one, get me one-on-one with someone. I'm really strong on that. And this is before I did all my group programs, I didn't have that. But at that stage, I knew I was good at one-on-one. And he said, right, your program could be, give me 6 managers and I will have 6 sessions with 6 of those managers. Right? Do you think that would help people? I was like, oh my God, yeah. If I did that, that would be that. And he goes, so go with that.
Absolutely.
And for Clasia, if you know your strong point is, give me a group of this many people, this amount, It's your program. Go with what your strong point is.
And here's one last thing I forgot to add. If you don't, sometimes you don't get to do an intake. You don't get to ask, you know, what is it there that they see they're up against or whatever. One time they asked me, we're going to do these half-day programs because we want people to get people interested in the principles, because a lot of people didn't want to commit to 2-3 days. So we did these, they were called Wisdom at Work, meaning we brought in all, we advertised to all these county employees, these short half-day, you know, seminars. So they asked each of us trainers in Santa Clara County to come up with one. So I'm sitting there thinking, county employees, now what is it about them? And I kind of knew about them because I'd been one. So I came up with a topic. It was called Stress is an Illusion. It's not what you think, or is it? You know, that was my title. But underneath, here's what I wrote. I said, do you fantasize winning the lotto? Are there days you want to give your kids away? Do you have the boss from hell? And then are there times when you really want to run away with the circus? And so I put these little bullet points, right? Mm-hmm. And I said, well, come, let's talk about, you know, why it is that we reach a point in our jobs or in our home life where it gets to whatever. I wrote this blurb about. Well, buses of people showed up. I mean, we had to do a wait list. And so I asked people, why did you come? And they said, well, how did you know that that was me, Cathy? How did you know that I think that? I said, well, probably because I think it too. But I hit them where they live. So if I work in the business world, you know, how many of you by the end of your week feel mentally drained, or do you feel inspired, or, you know, so you just sort of imagine, given this group of people, what would it be like for them? What is it that they're, you know, what are they up against? And so sometimes you just use your own imagination, but I use this phrase, hit people where they live. And I'm telling you that if you hit the right theme, they'll say, how did you know? Anyway.
I love that, Cathy. And again, what I would love to add to that is, because someone might be listening to this and going, Cathy, that's brilliant. I can't do that. I can't think of that. And I had a version of that, like when it came to copy or writing things like that, I'm like, I've got no idea. Other people are good, I'm not. And one of the things I found is we don't need to be good at everything.
No.
And you know, I've got this Facebook group, you know, online for coaches. One of the reasons that I created that group was because I wanted a place where it's only coaches who are interested in the three principles, so that we can help each other and we can talk to each other. So if you're listening to what Cathy's saying, you go, oh my God, that's brilliant. But I don't know my version of that.
But the point of that is I made something up relevant to that group. So what I'm saying is, if there's something you want to do, just make it up. I mean, just make it up. Well, if I were sitting in their shoes, what would I want to know about? You know, that's all I'm saying is just make that up, and you're going to come up with something totally different than I would. So that was the point, is use your own creativity. And it could be like what you're saying, do something that you feel comfortable with, that you start there. Absolutely.
And use the rest of the community.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I could not do this on my own. Many times when I speak at conferences, she gets really upset when I do this. But Linda Ramis has, she and I have been colleagues for years. And I always want to give her acknowledgement. I said, she's under the radar, but she's the brains behind the whole operation. It's because of her that I'm doing as much as I'm doing. And she gets upset because I want people to know about her. She gets mad at me. You did it again. I said, no, I'm not up here by myself. So yes, lean on people, connect to people, you know, support them, they support you. That's so important. Absolutely.
So I know we were actually trying to finish at 7. We've just gone 7:05. Okay. We've got any last question from anyone in the group? This is your final chance to answer something before we finish. I know we started a little bit late today.
I know. It's my fault. The whole system crashed on me.
It's all right. This is all part, same like coaching, right? We show up, we try it, It doesn't work.
We're doing this. We're going to be doing more of this too, right? We're going to do this again, or should I offer that? Oh, okay.
You've let the cat out of the bag.
Okay, I'm sorry. I was offering is a makeup session because I feel so, you know, I really don't want to.
Well, I would be up for that. So if you've got a question now, answer it. Or if you'd like a follow-up session with myself and Cathy on this topic or any other topic.
I'd be happy to do that.
Yeah, I would love to do that too, because I think we're just scratching the scratching the surface today. And I know so people don't know, but Cathy and I spoke last Tuesday, and I think we were supposed to be on the phone for about half an hour. We ended up being on the phone for like two hours.
Yes, which was fabulous. Unexpected.
And we were talking about things like this. I said, Cathy, we should be recording this conversation. So I'm very happy to do that if other people want to. Yeah.
But let's take one more question. Does somebody have one more question?
Okay, people are saying they're having to run. Helen's saying she would like more.
Okay.
Helen, so I'll just read a few comments. Eva was saying stress even resonates with the homeless.
Helen was saying stress would resonate
with lawyers that she knew. She's a barrister.
Big time. Yes. I would love lawyers to get exposed to this.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Eva's saying she would love a follow-up session on this topic. I just want to, I want to quickly, if we don't have a question, I want to say one thing, and that's Nikki wrote a message earlier on before you even joined, and because people were asking about starting out, and she's saying, following our last conversation just before Christmas, so Nikki and I had a conversation before Christmas, she put a post that I suggested. So Nikki put a post out on Facebook, which was very vulnerable. It was very open, very honest about how she felt. So you know exactly what you're saying about, you know, do you feel like this. So she shared that part of her rather than trying to be like the perfect coach and like she's got it all together.
And she said
I was contacted by an ex-colleague, and it looked like it's leading to a piece of work in prisons with their staff rather than the prisoners. This is a new area for me as I was working with small business. So I just wanted to kind of share that as well, that you guys don't need to be perfect. You can start wherever you are. Oh, we've got Grayson snuck in a question. Do you think about the income you will generate, or do you base it on the impact you will make and know the income will take care of itself?
The second piece. Yeah. And I know that's a big topic. And Ankush and I, we talked about that last week. I'm one of the people, I don't have a website, I don't do Facebook, all of that stuff. And I'm always working. So everybody does it different. You know, some people they need to support an organization. They have people working for them. So they certainly need to hit a higher mark in terms of money. Some people want to make money, and some people just want to be of service. Some people want to do both. I mean, to me, I don't care. If these principles get out into the world, however they get out there, it's only going to benefit all of mankind. So I think sometimes if it gets tied up in money, it won't go as far and as fast. It would be great if we had this generous person to, you know, put money on this, so that none of us have to worry about money and we can just get this out into the world. But unfortunately, that doesn't seem to be happening. So I really don't care about, you know, how people go about this. The most important thing is that you know, and it doesn't even, and I know people are going to have a fit when I say this, you cannot even have a good grounding around this and share this, and it's going to impact people. So this is truth in all human beings. Mm-hmm. So it's a done deal. Mm-hmm. And you just never know. You never know who's going to hear it, who's sharing it, how that's going to come about. So
I love that you said that. And I'm not having a fit. I gave a copy of a couple of books to a client. I hardly spoke to him. I gave him Inside Out Revolution by Michael Neal. It changed his life. I then gave him Somebody Should Have Told Us by Jack Pransky. I must have spoken to him for less than an hour. And after he read Somebody Should Have Told Us, he stopped.
That's it. So that's the power. You see, if you have a knowing about that, then and you're not attached to, well, I'm going to give this person the book and they're going to wake up to it and then they're going to want to work with me and I'm going to make all this money. See, you know, but you just did it to, you just did it for whatever reason you did it. And who knows where that's going to go. Yeah. And who knows what that's going to generate. And I know about what Nikki did. And so she's now, she's going to the head of a prison organization. Do you know how, usually you don't get access to that. Usually programs start with the inmates first and it works its way up. So I'm telling you, you never know who's listening. Yeah. You never know.
Well, thank you, Cathy.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you for being here. I love talking to you. I love that you're joining. I'm going to do a little plug. Cathy's going to be joining me for my Powerful Women's Immersion in April. Nikki is going to be there too. So
yay,
to meet Nikki there as well.
Absolutely.
And I love what you do. I love how you show up. You're such a great role model for everyone in this community. I'd love to do a follow-up, so we'll arrange that.
Yes, yes.
Thank you, everyone who's here. Martina said she met you 20 years ago. Wonderful to see you and hear you.
20 years ago, wow.
So, yeah, so it's awesome. So I'll stop the broadcast
okay,
now.
Okay, great.
You can stay on for a second. Thank you, everyone else, and I'll get this replay up soon.